sportbets.com – уникальное место для настоящего геймера. Только здесь возможны ставки на киберспортивные события. Ты знаешь толк в самых популярных играх и готов рисковать? Смотри регулярные трансляции и зарабатывай реальные деньги. eSportBets.com. Живой азарт и холодный расчет.
We are back once again here on Room on Fire. Welcome to the channel. It is brand new and we are very excited to be bringing you this first evening of broadcast of very, very many. There's still a lot to come here on the channel. But for now, we have Hellraisers playing against ESG in a best of one SLTV Starseries Season 10. And it's going to be on Mirage and I am not alone. Of course, I have some Ren Vendetta with me. What's going on, guys?
Well, just checking up on some TI results and eagerly anticipating the game to start.
We're not going to lie to you, Anders. We were just talking about how Liquid are out, trying to make sense of the brackets real quick during the break. Out.
What about Alliance?
Alliance are out.
Come on.
I got to play my song in a room full
no
of
more,
Swedes.
No more Rat Dota? I'm going to miss
no
it.
More Rat Dota.
people hate watching Rat Dota. I think it's exciting to watch.
Yeah. I agree.
I think it's exciting as hell.
All my friends keep saying that it's not, but I really do like it. But look, guys, we have no more time to talk about Dota because this is all about the Counter-Strike, as it will be on this channel for the future. Again, thank you so much for tuning in and supporting us because we really do appreciate it. Oh, that was some really loud noise. What was that?
Ben, your mic is messing up, dude.
Still doing it?
It sounds like it's push to talk. Or like, no, you had a fan going or something.
I don't have anything.
Maybe it's Skype. Try and take your Skype settings. You never know what it might be.
Skype strikes again!
Yeah, it happened, like, there, I think it's gone now.
Oh, Doja, can you do this, Doja? 1v2. Doja! No! He doesn't do it.
They find him in the end.
Everything's sorted now?
Yeah, it's
I'm not
all
making
good.
Noises?
Yeah,
it's
there we
all
go,
good, guys.
All right, good.
Okay, so look, guys, again, welcome to the channel. Thank you so much for supporting us. Thanks for tuning in. This is the channel that used to be NipTV, but now we've renamed it to Room on Fire. And thank you for joining us very much. You're watching the SLTV Star Series Season 10. It's Hellraisers versus ESG. Best of one game, and it will be Hellraisers starting off on the terrorist side. So welcome to the show, everyone. Sit back and enjoy yourselves, and hopefully, you know, either win or lose some skins, but still, you know, no matter what you do, you should have some fun.
Yeah, this game in particular, two of these teams, ESG, I think, have a real chance of doing some damage here to Hellraisers, even an upset. Like, it's an underdog situation, but Michelele already making the statement. He picks off Kucher at mid. Like, you cannot mess around with Michelele. He is on fire right now. Definitely a player to watch.
What I really loved about that is that Kucher actually had the deagle long range as well, so it was pretty manly from Michelele to step it up, but it worked out just fine. Grenades now raining in towards the B bomb side, but actually Hellraiser is just pouring in here, and it will be Markolov taking down the first player, then Angel with the second one. He's actually picked up a C-set 75, and that's now a 3-on-3 with the bomb down.
Hell of a shot there from Angel as well through Kitchen. That was a big kill, brought it back to a 3-on-3, and now he's waiting right around short. The flash goes over, but Angel is not blind. He gets one, he gets both! Angel with a double kill on short, cleans it up, and now it's all down to Delpan, who's on the site. But it's not looking good, he's caught in the triangle.
Yeah, the triangle of doom, right? That was no getting out of that one at all. He was right in the middle of everything, so not at all a good situation there. And a pretty good comeback there from Hellraisers. Vendetta, what do you think? It looked to me like early on ESG had the upper hand.
Yeah, definitely great start for ESG getting that entry frag in mid, but some great shots coming out from Angel, I think, is what made the round for Hellraisers. And it was pretty cool to see because they did go for a pretty unorthodox buy in that pistol. I think they had two C-Z75s and a deagle.
Yes.
And that's not something you see every day, but they made it work, even though Kucher got picked off with the deagle in mid. But it's cool to see them trying out new stuff.
Yeah, some nice adjustments coming out. And in this round, ESG go for no body armor. They pick up just a bunch of P250s. Pistol of choice, which is, I mean, it gets more and more interesting because it seems like more and more of the pistols become viable. You know, it could be the P250, it could be the 5.57, it could obviously be the Deagle or the, you know, the C-Z75. There's a pretty big, number of pistols you can choose from now.
That's really interesting, actually, that you point that out. P250s on three of those players at least.
Yeah.
So that's okay. Rogue does have the C. He does have the C-75, so he hasn't got his soul back quite yet. But it seems like the rest of the team are, you know, starting to gravitate back towards the P250, which is really interesting.
Well, as we say that, Emilio picks up a deagle.
Well, the deagle's alright. We're alright with the deagle.
And look at this, Rogue rushing up fairly aggressively in the middle here. Wish they would have had a flashbang to try and, you know, do this kind of push. But again, ESG here, not really investing into anything, just the pistols. I think it's a worthwhile investment. You know, $200 and you throw a flashbang from A over into middle and then you peek. You know, get lucky, you get a few kills in there.
Yeah, I think it's definitely worthwhile, especially if you're actually buying up, especially given how they didn't buy armor in the first eco round. So they definitely have money to spare, but I guess they want to make sure that they do have the cash needed to equip Delpan or Michaela with an AWP. And that's what I'm expecting to see right now.
That's the thing. They aren't quite there because they haven't really got that many kills in. All right, Delpan is going to go for the AWP. It's not Glass Cannon. He's got Kevlar, no helmet. But they didn't do any damage at all to Hellraisers in those two eco rounds.
Well, look who's also getting an AWP. It's Makalov. He's actually the one guy who's not boot camping, as far as I know. Everybody else in Hellraisers, I think, is boot camping with Dreamhack Valencia, which I think, I can't confirm it yet, but I think we might be covering as well here on the channel. But yeah, Makalov picking up one is definitely a switch up. It's, you know, for anyone who's a 1.6 fan, this will be like sweet music to your ears, just watching Makalov with an AWP. But for anyone else who used to, you know, only been following us in Global Offensive here, then maybe it's a little bit strange to see.
Yeah, Kucher has actually been the one who's been picking up the AWP more as of late, more so than the Makalov for Hellraisers. And he's definitely showed that he can be a very competent AWPer as well, but I wouldn't mind seeing Makalov picking up the AWP again.
No doubt. I mean, he's good with it. He's already shown. I mean, he can still AWP when he needs to, but it's not, it's we know right now for a fact for the Hellraisers, after I think we interviewed them at Fragbite, that it's really just a feel thing for them. It's like whoever feels like picking up the AWP, a lot like Nip, where it's just like, okay, I feel like going with it. Okay, fine. You go for it this round, right? That's kind of how it goes for Hellraisers. So maybe Markloff, he's been AWPing lately.
Look at this comeback. They actually were in a 5-on-3, and now they've turned it back into a 3-on-3. Unless Mikey Lily can stop them here, this bomb is going to go down, and it will be all of a sudden Hellraisers claiming back a round that they definitely should not be winning right now, and that's a very important kill coming in there for Michael. Now it's going to be down to Hellraisers, Kucha, and Makalov left. 2-on-3. Kucha has a chance of getting a double. He's going to walk in. Rogue goes down, and he keeps shooting. No! He can't take down Mikey Lily. The bomb does get planted, but Makalov's alone. He's going to get taken down by Hutton, and that's going to be it. ESG win back the round, and very nicely done. I feel like that could have been even more smooth on them, but I'm glad they managed to reset at the end there.
It probably could have been a tad bit smoother. I think Amelia was a bit unfortunate not to peek out Adren coming out of apps there, because that was just a matter of centimeters before you could see even the barrel of his gun or Adren's arm. So that was really unfortunate, and that kind of led to Hellraisers getting onto the site and getting that bomb plant. But still works out for the Swedish guys in the end. They do pick up the round, and they manage to hold on to an AWP. And actually, we see Michael Lele picking up an AWP as well.
Yes, and yeah, that's a pretty mean crossfire here. Delpan and Michael Lele both with an AWP, and over at the B-bomb site, it's Rogue and Cutin with a FAMAS and an M4 just, you know, holding down here. And so far, again, Hellraisers is starting off losing two players without getting anything in return. So that's not the kind of start they were looking for.
What a flick shot from Mikey Lele, though. Catches Doja jumping by behind Van, just a split second shot, and he gets it. That's 3 AWP kills so far this round for ESG, and now Rogue has to step in and ruin the party. Gets one with the FAMAS, but that's down. It's down to Markalov now, and the bomb is dropped over at B site. So he's still stuck at top mid right now, Markalov. He's nowhere near this bomb. The real question is, you know, can he actually like live through this, or does he want to throw his life away?
Yeah, well, he's going to be walking out with his back turned to Kriton, and he's going to be going down. So it's the second round for ESG. Man, is that your squeaky chair I can hear in the background?
Mm-hmm.
It must be.
What?
I need my squeaky chair, too.
I have my squeaky chair, but I'm not sure if you can hear mine just as much. I'm hearing some sort of squeaky chair anyway. Look, you know, that's just a completely sidetracked here. What can they do here, Hellraisers? Because it feels like these two AWPs are going to be pretty hard to deal with.
Yeah, especially if they can't retain an AWP of their own. I mean, sure, Markloff's out and about searching for a frag, but he couldn't connect on the shot towards Emilio on the A site earlier in that round. And if they can't really get the opening frags with the AWP, I think they're going to have a really rough time actually getting any control over the mid area.
Yeah, so they say screw the middle. Let's go for the A bomb site and use flash and smoke to try and, you know, get rid of the AWPs, push them back. And that's working out right now. If only they would put on a little bit more speed. They need to get this bomb down quick before the actual smokes disappear. Otherwise, they're of no use at all. And now, well, Delpan misses the shot. He's going to go down. A big opening given here to Hellraisers. I think probably the bomb carrier should have died then. So a big mistake coming out from Delpan. It's going to be Hutton left and Rogue. And one is going to go down, leaving Rogue in a 1-on-3. And he should definitely run here. I think that round could have turned on a dime if Delpan had get that shot off before the bomb went down.
I think you're absolutely right. That was a fortunate string of events for Hellraisers, because that should have been pretty easily shut down from ESG's side.
Yeah.
And instead it ends up being 4-2, and they actually survive with quite a few people as well. Oh, as I say that, Adren dies from the bombs. But still, they managed to hold on to an AWP and an AK. That's pretty decent for the kind of buy they went into the round with.
Oh man, that's, you know, coming off of a two-round victory here for ESG means, well, they can still buy losing that round, but they spent a lot of money doing it. They only had the AWP. If they lose this upcoming round, it's going to get really tricky. And as a result, they're going to go for a bit of a switch up here, putting Delpan on the back in the window and then having Mike a little bit further. But he actually falls back. I thought he was going to push up further.
This is a very important round for both teams, actually, because their money is all over the place. In both cases, this is a weird mix buy or an eco. Whoever loses this, but Emilio right up to the smoke, he's gonna get two as well. Doja and Angel both picked off at pit, and now it's Adrian who smashed to sneak his way out onto the site. He finds Mike and they looking towards apartments. Good punish there from him, but ESG are sitting on the bomb in pit.
Yeah, see if they can take care of Emilio here and turn this back into a 2-on-3 before Adrian goes down. And well, it's a little bit too late. Emilio's gonna run away. They can give the bomb to Kutra if they feel like it and just let him run away. And a bit of a pause coming in here. What was really interesting, I think, is that Emilio was actually... Do you see the way he was trying to look for the smoke then?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's one of the things that has happened with the recent updates. Not the most recent one, but the one where they tried to fix the smokes.
Yes.
There was some side effects to that attempted fix. Now you can, there's several sneaky ways they can actually see through smokes, or kinda see through smokes, and the best players are gonna take advantage of that.
Yeah, Emilio's not the first to do it. We've seen a couple of people do it. I saw it at ESCA LAN as well, and that's just what it is. You know, you can, if you look down into the ground, you can sort of at the top of your screen just peek through there. Actually, that wasn't even what got him the kill, but still, pretty good job round here from ESG. Kucha's going to be running in 15 seconds as he goes down, and it is a triple kill from Emilio, and a third round for ESG. So, I mean, that's Hellraisers now in turn, with no bomb plant and no money to buy.
Exactly. And, well, I mean, ESG, it's a good thing that so many people lived as well, because they're going to be able to stretch their money somewhat, get full equipped again, without taking too much of a heavy hit to their economy here. They need another buffer round, like a really solid round where they can just shut Hellraisers down and build a little bit of money on their side. Hellraisers sticking to pistols, and Delpan already getting the first kill. He even legs Adrian jumping past, so good start here for the Swedes.
Yeah, and Delpan just doesn't care. He's going to get a bunch of kills in the middle. Three before he goes down. He almost killed two more, and it's going to be easy for the rest of his team to clean up here. Hutton and Rogue coming in with a kill each. That equalizes the score, and we are back to 4-4. And this is pretty good news. I think one guy from ESG disconnected. He's going to be back, but we've got to remind everyone this is a CT-sided map, so it is on EST to pick up the majority of the rounds. Now, it's not as CT-sided as Nuke or Train or something like that, but still, you know, I think if they get to 9-6 or 8-7, it's going to be a pretty even match here.
Yeah, I'd agree with that assessment. It's not overly biased for CTs or overly in favor of the CT side, but yeah.
Yeah, it is up there, right? You do want to win the majority anyway.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So, okay, just to go through what's happened so far, we've seen some pretty good double AWP defense from ESG, and Hellraisers has managed to break that by going for, you know, the most basic A strategy there is on this map, which is, you know, smoking off two smokes towards the connector of the jungle, and then one guy, or one smoke towards the CT spawn, and then you just push in, put the bomb down, and take it from there. Do you think that's something that they're going to try and repeat here once we resume the game?
I wouldn't be too surprised to see it. I mean, obviously, if you find something that's working for you, you should never stray away from that. But we've seen Hellraisers do a lot of weird stuff in previous games.
I like the timing of it, really. When they figured out, okay, ESG are starting to wise up here a little bit, and then when they're on the brink of really running out of money, they managed to get three rifles and two pistols, I think, for that round with the smokes.
Yeah.
They just decide to go for basic bread and butter, right? A very cool strat that lets you get out onto the site, and it just happens to go that way at that time, as you know, you guys were talking about with Delpan not being able to stop the plant. But that's a very good strat that I expect Hellraisers to keep using.
Yeah.
Just because it's so effective. If you can get those smokes down and make it upslope without getting torn to shreds by nades, etc., it's very tough to stop for that. It really comes down to what? ESG keeping their cool, hanging back, letting the smokes clear, and then going in for the retake.
Yeah, and one other thing that makes that A push even stronger is the fact that they probably recognize, or they definitely recognize, that ESG are doing two ops with Delpen and Michaela. And doing, it's like I said, obviously with these smokes, it's pretty easy for a T-Sata team to get into the bomb site and at least get somewhat control over the bomb, or yeah, bomb spot. The issue for ESG is the fact that they do have two ops, so a retake is going to be a lot harder than what it would have been with just one op.
True.
And that's definitely in Hellraiser's favor, because normally you'd see teams, when they recognize the various smokes coming in towards the A bomb site, they just fall back and are full of contempt with actually just going for a retake, because that's what good teams do. They have planned out scenarios for how they're going to play everything if there's an A retake that needs to happen. But I'm not really sure how prepared they can be with two ops, because it's going to be really tough to actually get in there.
Yeah. I mean, we saw that earlier, and especially if one of them goes down, then all of a sudden you just, I mean, you're gonna have to rely on Hellraisers to make some pretty big mistakes for it to go your way again. I think we're still waiting for Michaela to get back in. So while we're doing that, I really want to thank all of you for tuning in. Now 19,000 people watching this channel, and I gotta say, you know, when you remake a channel like we did, I was a little bit worried that maybe people are gonna be like, oh, you know, how can we find the new channel? Where is it gonna be at? And all that confusion. I'm glad you guys
not even recognize the name.
Exactly.
Well,
you know
that's the thing.
Yeah, so I am really, really happy so many of you wanted to tune in. I hope you're going to follow the channel and you know, come back in the future like you've been previously. In terms of what's going on at the channel, so far not that much has changed, but already tomorrow there's going to be stuff coming up. New announcements, can't tell you what it is yet, but I can just tease you a little bit. And I'm glad you guys wanted to, you know, follow us on this pretty exciting journey. It's going to be even more crazy in the future, I hope. But for tonight, we've just got this going on. And we would have had more games as well, but this is going to be the last one of the evening because all the teams, and I'm guessing a pretty large proportion of you guys, are going to be watching the World Cup as well. Obviously, Germany playing Argentina, right?
Yeah.
So that's,
I thought so.
I think Germany are looking pretty good going into this.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Germany has just looked extremely solid all tournament. They play like German machinery, but they also play entertaining football. And previously, if you go back to the early 90s and 80s, they were just a machinery that somehow won games. I think it was Gary Lineker who said a game versus Germany is 22 men go out on a field to play football, 90 minutes later Germany has won, like something to that effect. Because they were just so structured in how they played, and they're the same way, except they're playing really, really fun football. And that's, I hope actually they win this World Cup. I feel like they deserve it.
Well, I feel like I'm a little bit biased because Semler and I got a bit of a taste of some of that German spirit when we were down in Berlin. That's when they beat Brazil 7-1. We were in Berlin at that point, and safe to say things got a little bit out of control, as we had already agreed to take a shot and a beer every time. There was a goal scored.
Yeah.
We should have really thought that through. Just, you know.
We didn't.
No.
I don't think any of us expect. Like, that's the thing. It's that silly thing where you're just like, there's no way. Like, they'll win, like, 2-1 or something. Like, it's fine. And then, of course, with it, by the end of the first half, it's like 5 goals for Germany.
Yeah.
And you realize you're about to be very sad for another 50 minutes.
But it was fantastic. I mean, in the streets of Berlin afterwards, people driving around, fireworks, people hanging out of the taxis, just being super excited and friendly. And it was, it was worth it. It was worth it at the end.
Oh, yeah. We lucked out being there at that time. That was really cool.
Definitely. Big thanks to everyone who's been subscribing. Just noticed Crusader 1349 subscribing, but I saw a couple of other people earlier. I can't really read out all the subscribers when we're doing it, but really do appreciate it a lot now that we're running our own thing. It helps us even more to keep the channel active and keep, you know, content on here, which we will be doing. Goal is to cover as much as we can and also maybe to do a little bit more than that even. So we will see. Still waiting. I think actually, where is he? I'm going to check Skype, see what's going on. Still waiting for Michaelita to get back online so we can continue with the game here.
Yeah, it might be a little bit. It looks like they're going to. That's it. ESG are going to go for a sub, because I think Michaelita, that's it. He's done.
He's simply retired for the evening. That's unfortunate.
Yeah. So they've got PETA.
He really wanted to see the World Cup. Like he was already halfway drunk, you know, down to his second six pack. He was just good to go, so he just pulled his TP cable and that was it.
Exactly. Just decided, no more. I have to get mentally prepared for this. Well,
you know, I guess the Swedes got to take any excuse, seeing as how they weren't in this World Cup.
Yeah.
Hey. A lot of countries weren't.
Yeah.
There's no shame in that.
We haven't been to a championship in quite some time, so.
1992 for Denmark, never forget, right?
Yeah, that was a pretty sick Danish team, though.
it was also the last one that really worked, so, you know.
Okay. Yeah, but at least you've gotten to go to tournaments. We end up getting second in the qualifiers and getting to the playoff stages of the qualifiers and then playing the first seed of that said qualifier and just dreams being crushed everywhere.
He's back, apparently. Could it be true?
Huh. The dream is alive.
It's real life.
Yeah, his ping seems to have settled. All right. Well, then, in that case, if you're just joining us, then welcome to the channel. You're watching Room on Fire. And, yes, we're casting the SLTV Star Series Season 10. I'm Anders, with me Summer and Vendetta, as always. Hope you guys are enjoying yourselves. We are still in the first half of this game. Best of one. And the score is 4-4 right now, with Hellraisers winning the pistol round and then just winning a single round after that, in fact. So if you take that trend into account, guys, I mean, you know, We're talking one of the five rounds going in favor of Hellraisers after the initial pistol rounds, you know. How does that feel?
I still think Hellraisers are definitely the team to be feared, I guess, in this game. I think they've gotten off to a pretty good start. Obviously, yes, you being on the favorite side, they do have the chance to just shut out Hellraisers completely, but I don't know. Hellraisers are once again going towards the bomb site, and they made this work last time around.
Yeah, they did. Emilio goes down. This time, not as much success as last time. Delpan making sure nobody's coming up from the middle. It is a 2-on-3, though, and right now it's still ESG with the advantage, unless they can get just one more kill in here. Dosha, I'd really want him to wait for Markolov and then see if they can time something. Delpan spots one. Not going to be a kill, and then he's going to get smoked off. Is he going to peek out anyway? That could have been dangerous. Dosha still moving up here. Markolov coming in to help out from the apartments. Rogue is right at the corner, and Dosha gets spotted. He's going to go down. That leaves Markolov alone in a 1-on-3 with the bomb out of his control as well. And he's going to go down to Delpan. So there is the round for ESG. And now Hellraisers, again, without any money and things not looking too hot at the moment.
No, blind spray there for Markolov as well. Lucky for him that he couldn't quite get something. But ESG is still... Delpan did take a peek, he did take a risk, I guess, just to get the information, but still, the fact that they hung back and actually played to their numbers, that man advantage was so important there. Because if Delpan actually goes full bore and tries to get a kill or something like that, throws it away, brings it back to a 2-on-2, Hellraisers are in a good spot, so... ESG keeping it together, even after having that long pause.
Yeah, now Mike Killily and Delpan and Emilio as well, everybody chiming in to clean up this eco round from Hellraisers. Not even an attempt at putting down the bomb, they just got destroyed as they ran in. And that round's over in a second, and then we're on to the 11th round.
Yeah, what I think is pretty cool, though, from what Hellraisers are doing with that A push of theirs, is the fact that they're not throwing that many nades, really. And Adrenaline is just more or less walking out of apps instantly. Not really caring about what's around him. And he's done that twice and actually gotten a kill.
Yeah.
Both times. So it's a pretty cool way to play from Hellraisers. Unfortunately for them, both times they've done it as of late, Emilio has pushed aggressively towards the A pit, catching some people off guard. So that little push they get from Adren getting out of apps is negated by Emilio picking up one or two frags in the A pit.
Yeah, you're right, but if they do get onto a bomb site with all those grenades still intact, it means once the bomb is down, Hellraisers can really hold on to the bomb site for a long time. So we'll see if that actually happens or not. Pretty good grenade coming out from Michaelili, landing down towards the underpass, and it's going to take Kucha down. Pretty low on health now. Hithin is waiting up here. They're going to be boosting in. Kucha should be going down right here. Gets backstabbed, in fact, and Dosha will get the return kill.
Nice control there by Doja, managing to pick that up. But then is caught. Now Delpan looks towards Pit, finds Angel. There's still a man up in A apartments though for Hellraisers, so perhaps he can catch Delpan off guard here, take a peek towards those stairs, and he will do that. It's the duel, back and forth exchange, and the flank from Doja through the smoke catches Delpan on the stairs.
And that right there was an you know, the map has actually changed. You can shoot through this wood here. Delpan, he got killed from exactly that. So pretty nice adjustment, realizing already, Doja, that you can actually shoot through that wood panel that's been added recently, which is an interesting change. I'm not sure I'm even against it. I think it's actually kind of cool.
It is very neat. I mean, that's options right there, and he knew exactly where Delpan was. He was able to open things up. But unfortunately for Hellraisers, that Emilio will find one more. So it's down to Adrian and Doja now. They have the bomb, at least, and they're trying to sneak their way out onto A-site, but there are two members here for ESG, and now Emilio confirms it, spots one, and gets both. Great play from Emilio. What a round.
Yeah, Emilio has really been instrumental in a lot of these rounds that ESG has picked up. I think he's gotten... right there, he got two frags, but in the round towards A, where Hellraisers really tried to get onto that A-bomb site, he's been shutting them down early on, and I think that's been key for ESG, especially since they have played with two ops, which I previously mentioned, that would make a retake harder. So Emilio getting those early frags in is really big for ESG.
Yeah, it is. Now we have a little bit of a pause coming up, actually just on pause as I said that, but things are looking good right for ESG. They've managed to regain control of the match, and as we said, now after the first three rounds, which followed from the pistol round, it's actually been just one out of seven now that has gone in favor of Hellraisers, so we'll see if they can manage to get back. They don't need that many rounds here. If they can get one or two more, I think they're going to be able to have a pretty good second half, but they need to get more than four, I think, in the first half.
Yeah, I think
I agree.
Five or six.
Yeah.
That's something they could be comfortable with. And I'm not really sure if he caught it early on, but Emilio actually naded himself in CT spawn. I'm not really sure what that was about, but...
Maybe he's feeling down. Sorry. Well, Hellraisers, he's thinking,
trying to play with a handicap.
Yeah, they need something going their way, but and this round is definitely it. Rogue goes down as well. We're looking so far at a flawless round, and just Delpan left here with an AWP in hand. They do have money to rebuy, especially because Rogue somehow has $15,000 on his hands. But you know, still a good start here for Hellraisers to what might be a bit of a comeback.
That's very solid. Delpan spots the man on A side as well. He's just trying to hang in here and do as much damage as he can. He gets another kill. Delpan with the flash as well. Doja's blind, but he barely makes it around the corner to stay alive. So now they've got him boxed in. Delpan isn't going anywhere.
There it is. They take care of him. And it shows you a little bit of what Delpan can do. Just not afraid at all, even in that 1-on-5. And two kills like that can make a difference. I mean, if Hellraisers lose the upcoming round, they're going to need the rifles that they just lost. And I guess another... That's my killer there again disconnecting, unfortunately. 7-5 is what we're looking at. And let's see how we're going to progress once we're back. Again, we do apologize for all these delays, guys, but it is ultimately out of our control. But what do you guys think about this map change? I mean, the one change is you know, the fact that there's only like one wooden window over here by the B-bomb site, and the other one is the big one, I guess, is this wood panel. Then they also changed the way this is blocked off. It's less blocked now between the window room and the whorehouse, as we sometimes call it.
Yeah, I think... The bigger change out of all the ones they made is obviously the wooden panel and the CT connector, which could play out. Well, I guess we have to see. It could play out to be really well or a really good thing for the T's, or it could just be just a nifty thing. I don't really think it's gonna do too much for the CT's. I just think that it's gonna be more of a worry for them, especially if you're playing, if you're holding apps from the connector area. Like by jungle or by the connector. Other than that, I don't think it's going to have too much of an impact. But I'd rather see them sort out the various wall banging issues on this map. I'm not really sure. There's been a ton of threads on the CSGO subreddit about it. How same like the same materials have different penetration values. Mm-hmm. So you can spam through some places on the left side of a door, but not the right side, those type of things. So I'd like to see them do like sort of those type of things before they add more stuff or change more stuff about the map.
Oh, a start has been given. Markolov and a leg shot as well with the AWP. We saw him pick up earlier and he didn't really do that much with it, but this time he is getting on the way. We have the game resumed. So we'll see if this is going to be a round for Hellraisers. Kryten getting flashed, and he's down to 13. Look how low they all are, and now they start to fall. Emilio is next. Delpan waiting inside. He misses the shot, and there's no time for that. They're all coming for him. There's only four people, and well, four people coming. He's alone in the bomb site. He's gonna go down, and now Rogue is left, and they are running out of money here. Two of their people have, but the rest really don't have that much to buy on here. So this is a dangerous path they're heading down right now, ESG.
Yeah, especially since Hellraisers are on the brink of picking up that sixth round, and that's what we're talking about. They needed to get 5 to 6 rounds to start feeling comfortable on their T half, Hellraisers. They're about to do that, if not better, because there's still a couple rounds left in this half for Hellraisers to do damage. And with ESG in such a weird state economically, it's not looking good for the Swedes. They've also just lost. I mean, the thing is, Michelele getting caught out in this game and is no longer, you know, he's no longer in this match. He's a heavy hitter for ESG. He's one of the two guys that really does a lot of the heavy lifting for the team. Delpan is the other. So PETA, he has some pretty big shoes to fill right now. He has to make a difference.
Yeah, PETA recently retired, right? So
yep, working at a bank.
Yeah, but obviously, you know, just retirement won't make you lose all the skills you have, and PETA has a lot of them. So we'll see if it's going to come back. Maybe he'll just come back to playing again because he, you know, he loves it so much. Please,
well, you never really retire from Counter-Strike.
It's true.
You?
We've got just you figured out already, PETA. We've got you figured out. This time they pick up the first kill on Angel, and Delpan does drop down to 18 health, but finally a good turnaround here for ESG. Now they just need to win the last two rounds and make this 9-6, and they will be in a decent position.
Right now, look at Emilio right now. He's pushing into A apartments. I love this from ESG. This is something we saw LGB do all the time on Mirage. But hold that thought. It's going to be a B push here coming out for Hellraisers. They get the entry, but Hoyten is still alive by bench. He manages to sneak his way onto the site as well, but Adrian point blank gets two kills on him and PETA both.
And not looking too hot right now. Emilio in a 1-on-3, and they've relied on him to do a lot, but this time it won't happen. It's Markolov with one AWP shot, one Deagle shot. Seems like it really is back to basics for Markolov, right? I mean, AWP and Deagle, it doesn't get very much more Counter-Strike than that, I think. 7-7 is the scoreline. We're moving into the 15th round, and ESG without much money to buy at the moment, which is unfortunate.
We can see Delpan taking use of that price reduction to the scouts. He's got that picked up, but he doesn't buy armor, even though he's got obstacle for a nade and a pistol instead.
Emilio gets taken down, and there's Delpan with the scout shot. Goes for a second one, but it will be PETA helping him out with the FAMAS up close. A pretty good combo. Delpan jumping again. Not going to connect with a shot, and he's going to go down in the end. Kryten dies, and it is Hellraisers who come up with the majority of the round. 8-7 here for the first half after some unfortunate turn of events here for ESG. That's what it's down to.
Yeah, really unfortunate that Michael Lilla had some issues with his internet connection, but that happens from time to time. It's not like PETA is a bad sub by any means, but it's definitely going to mess up their team dynamic.
And so switching over to the T side. Yeah, that's the thing. CT side, it's like you can kind of go back to the basics, I guess, and just be like, okay, we're going to hold this way, guys, right? Bread and butter. But T side is, I mean, T side, unless you're hitting those shots, bread and butter. You need to throw a little spice in there, right? And that's where having your roster, having Michelele playing here would make the difference maybe for ESG.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that.
I mean, they need everything to work out just right at the moment. They're one round down. They need to start off by winning the pistol round here and then just keep trucking on from there. Again, if you're just joining us, then welcome to Room on Fire. If you're just joining us, then this is the first time we're live with the channel, and we're super excited. Thanks so much for tuning in, guys. Hopefully, we can bring you a lot more cool Counter-Strike content here on the channel. We have a lot of big goals and big plans and everything, but we can't reveal all of them just yet. Tomorrow, though, is going to be a new day, and we'll see what goes on. I'm Anders, with me is Semler and Vendetta, and let's get it on here. What do you think, Semler? Kucha in the middle, waiting with a P2000 of all weapons.
P2000, get that headshot. He's looking for that information, and they're already doing quite a bit of damage to him as well. He's dropping low, but he's given his... I mean, he's doing a decent bit of damage to the guys at top mid there for ESG.
Look at over here, Docius waiting two people. Is he going to walk out? He hears the grenades. He's just waiting. He goes for the first one. There's one second, and he's running out of bullets. And Docius, he should be gone, and he is gone. And Molotov's going to come up. They're running through. That's not wise. Oh, no. Rogue goes down, and Kryten is going to be alone in a 1-on-4. I don't know what possessed them to run through the fire, but you definitely should not. Unless, you know, the room is on fire, then you can sort of...
That nade, though. That nade did 85 damage in one.
Oh, man. Yeah, that was a bit of a chaotic situation. But actually some very cool aggressive play from Hellraisers. I love that position from Docius.
Yeah, it actually played really well with... It seems like that was the initial idea all the way. Doja playing up so aggressively that it might lead ESG to think that if they manage to pick him off, then that's an opening for the B-bomb site. And instead, you have Doja kind of playing the role as the bait for Angel's Molly. So that was pretty cool to see, and it worked out pretty well for Hellraisers.
This time, it's ESG's turn to charge in, but a good grenade from Doja takes down one. Then for Master to pick up another one, he's actually going to throw it away and just pull out the pistol. He didn't even want to touch that rifle anymore after missing some of those shots. And it will be around for Hellraisers anyway. They do pick it up, but ESG got some good kills in. If only they could have got the bomb down, it would have been so much better. That would have meant they could have actually bought in this round. Instead, now, they are forced to eco once more, and the score is already 10-7.
Look at Markolov with the P90 Asimov as well.
Markolov has so many skins. It's ridiculous. I'm actually jealous.
Oh, well, this is a slaughter right now for, Hellraisers. Kuchu even taking his time about that. He was really wanting to land that headshot on Peeta.
I think Markolov might be one of the guys who has the most skins in the game right now. I think there is... If there was a contender at, like, a pro level, it'd probably be Weber, right?
Oh, man, that's
Does anyone
tough.
Know how many skins Weber has? I don't know, but I have a sneaky suspicion it is a scary amount.
Well, they do. People get into skins. I mean, those are collectibles. People put in work to get more skins, which is a good thing, obviously.
Yeah. Fun all the time.
It is fun. I do think it's fun. But look at this now. It's the first time, and actually Hellraiser's Markolov, look at where he's holding, right where Emilio was, except he has a P90, so if they come charging through, he's got 50 bullets to try and get something done. There's the first one through Emilio hiding in the corner. Markolov takes him down, and now more people coming through. He can't see a thing, and actually he's going to go down. This is working out really well for ESG at the moment.
Yeah, so far this has actually panned out great. Kuchar is going to try and put some spray through, catch them as they're making their way to the site. It's not going to be good enough, though. The nade, however, does manage to do some pretty decent damage on that A site, but... Quid then looking towards CT, catches Adrian, and now it's down to a 4-on-2 situation. Hellraisers, they're boxed into CPL in mid. They're not really going to be able to get in here and do this. They have to start thinking about how to save.
Yeah, I agree, especially because Doja took a very long time sneaking all the way up behind and all the way up to the top of middle. And that time is something they should have, you know, they could have used that time to try and get some pickoffs, maybe see if they could reduce it to a, you know, 2-on-3 or something like that. But now it's definitely too late, and they will run away. Oh, but that, I mean, a lot of that round, I think, hinged on the idea that Markolov could have pretty picked up a double or maybe a triple kill with that P90 in the position he was in. But it doesn't work out that way, and ESG are there right back in it.
I actually think Markolov did his job. Got the first frag on Emilio, and after he picks up that frag, the jig is kind of up. Everyone knows where he is, and it's a very limited space he can hide in and try to dodge bullets. So I think it was more up to Angel not getting picked up instantly by Delpan. I think that definitely would have done more for them, because it's a limited amount you can do with a P90 in that kind of situation, unless they just come bomb rushing into you.
Oh, look at that. Now Delpan actually caught in the corner. He's taking a lot of damage. He's still going to get the kill. They are not taking him down now. Grenade to follow. Delpan is going to get exploded. So that's a pretty good return grenade. And Doja, once again, aggressive up here. They're going to be charging right through. He jumps on top of him. That's definitely bad mannered. And Doja is going to punish them. Takes down Huthan as his next target. And now it's Emilio and Peeta. 2-on-3 here. And the bomb is dropped off in the apartments.
What a play by Doja, so sick, but now it's, yeah, this is it. Bomb is up in apartments and Doja is sitting on it. They'd still manage to find Emilio as well, and the last man picked off by Markolov in kitchen.
He actually landed on him. Rogue actually cool. Jumped on Doja.
I thought for a second there that it would just be, you know, Doja, he's going to get caught immediately, you know, it's just the face stomp, the curve stomp, but...
I was wondering Doja if they were going to go for something really, you know, he was trying to actually mount him and ride him into the bombsite, you know, maybe, you know, next level play
been
like that.
Pretty spectacular.
Piggyback riding your enemy into the bombsite and then winning.
The riding crop.
Alright, well, that means actually ESG, without a bomb plant that round, they just can't afford to buy. It's 12-8, Doja takes the first kill, and this is not looking good. They do have one smoke on Peeta, so they might try and see if they can put the bomb down. He's already put it thrown into the site, yeah, and that's definitely a smoke that's meant for a bomb plant, but I don't think they can make this work.
Oh, this is gonna be tough. They're stuck in pit still. Everyone from Hellraisers knows they're coming. And yeah.
Nice shots there by Adrian, though.
That was cool, calm, and collected, just one-tapping them down.
Yep, 8-13, and it's going to be another buy round for ESG, but I'm starting to get a little bit worried for the Swedish team here.
Agreed.
Yeah, they need to pick up a round now, because if they lose this one round, it's back to eco. All of a sudden, Hellraisers at 15 rounds, and I think it's all but over from there. Or it's just over from there.
Look at this pretty jump much. From Kucha. Look how quickly he's up into the apartments. Actually, he's not going to get a shot just yet. Rogue is waiting right at the edge. But the fact that he went up on the box and then jumped up instead of going for the ladder means he's there much quicker. And he will pick off Rogue. And this is kind of Kucha's style of AWPing that we've seen on Inferno as well. He's not the mad flick shot AWPer, but he's just very cool, just sitting one angle and holding it very well.
Yeah, it's that patience. That's the patience there. Defensive sort of AWPer really just kind of waits for you to walk into the crosshairs. Thorin would have a field day with this. But for now, at least, it is going to be Markolov holding double spray, pushing all the way up to A pit. He's going to manage to actually stop the bomb in his tracks. PETA finally comes through and gets a good shot there.
Now it's a one-on-one.
How, in the blink of an eye, did they go 2 kills for PETA and 2 kills for Delpan?
I have no idea. The sad thing is that the bomb is being controlled by Kucha, and Delpan also has 1 HP. And he's going to take a giant trek all the way around the map and just hope that Kucha won't realize he's coming from behind. I mean, what do you think of, and at this point, where does Kucha actually position himself to play this really well?
Well, I think actually, as awkward as his current position is, I think this is a pretty good choice. He limits as many options, really, for Delpan as possible, And I think a lot of it's going to come down to whether or not Delvin decides to pick up the bomb or not before he goes searching for Kucha.
He's basically right underneath him at this point, and there's only 8 seconds left. Bomb gets picked off. Kucha's still waiting, and he goes for the kill. And we'll get it, of course, just 1 HP triple for Kucha. A little bit of an uncomfortable situation for Delpan. And, you know, I guess that was actually a decent angle. I was really scared, but, I mean, it's 90 degrees here. You can't really see much of anything. You're going to have to basically just guess that he's there if you want to go for that one.
Yeah, it's a pretty awkward situation 9 out of 10 times, but given the situation, it actually worked out pretty nicely because he didn't want to go too far away from the bomb. He would like to have the opportunity to punish Delpan the second he picks up the bomb, so really well played by Kucha.
Oh, Angel still fighting in the middle. That was a great early deagle shot coming out from Delpan. I think he actually wanted to go for a second one, but his teammates all sat down in front of him and more or less blocked his shot. I'm not sure if he would have got that kill on Angel. Either way, it's back into a 2-on-3, and still looking pretty good for Hellraisers. They're about to be on match and map point unless they throw this 2-on-2 away.
That was actually Markolov getting caught by Hoyten camping below window there. Don't think Markolov expected that at all. He didn't seem like he was reacting in time. But what's interesting is look at Adrian's position right now.
Yeah, the entire A bomb site is open.
Yep, it is. But Emilio and Hoyten can't really know that, so they're still sneaking their way forwards. As if there was someone in here, and that's what they should do, of course, checking every angle. I think Doja spotted them now, so he knows that... No, does he? They should know. Adrian is really out of position, and so is Doja right now.
They have to know this is A. Well, now they definitely know after the bomb goes down, but this is something that never should happen if you're Hellraisers. You should not be allowing an ecoing team to get the bomb plant like that.
No, you're right. They have... Actually, no grenades on Hellraisers. They're gonna have to go for it straight away. Instant headshot here. And Doja's down to 9 HP. Adrian's gonna have to come and help out. He will and takes down one. Curtin repeats and no, he doesn't get the kill. Adrian will take him down. That looked so close. That was actually a very smart play from ESG hiding both members down there. Because once you kill the first guy, I think instinctively you just think, okay, the next guy must be hiding in a different spot. Let's look for him. And they thought it was apartments, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. You could see... Adrian kind of just looking everywhere at that point. Unfortunately, from ESG, they weren't able to take him down instantly. If they do that, I think they win the round because Doja was down to 9 HP at that point. And also, they actually managed to get a pretty good plant for that, or an excellent plant given their afterpoint position. So a bit unfortunate from the Swedes.
Now it's definitely falling apart here. 15-8, and already 2 kills happening for Hellraisers. PETA, Quitten, and Rogue are left, and they're going to have to try and see if they can fight for overtime or draw. I can never remember if it's overtime or draw in this league.
Not in Star Series, no.
Yeah, it's regular league play, so draw is the name of the game.
Yep. Alright, so they're going to have to fight for the draw here. PETA coming up from underpass. Kucha already watching. Adrian takes down Rogue, and we're back into a 2-on-5. And the Swedes, it's just not their day here. Some connection issues, and then Quitten left alone. And he's going to go down to Markolov, gets the last kill of the match, and ends up still at the bottom of the scoreboard, but a pretty good match overall from Hellraisers. And ESG, they're going to have to try their luck next time. But ladies and gentlemen, that's all we have for tonight. Samurai and Vendetta, what do you think? Is there anything else we need to say about that match?
Well, just have to point out that it's really unfortunate that Michaelola had connection issues, because I think with the way ESG has been playing the last couple of weeks, they're definitely a team that could potentially beat Hellraisers. So I think, yeah, Michaelola basically not being able to play messed up a lot.
Yeah, I agree.
That's pretty much it. It's just we can't take anything away from this match because, unfortunately, we lost one of the players halfway through. And I think that really... Yeah.